Shalom. First and foremost, I want to give all praises, honor, and infinite glory to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem Rakakwadash. Forgive me the spirit to do this lesson. Yahweh being the name of the Heavenly Father, Bahashem meaning in the name of, Yahweh Shai being the name of Yahweh's only begotten Son and our Lord and Savior, also who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ, Bahashem Rakakwadash, meaning in the name of the Holy Spirit, the bond to the elders and apostles, a great millstone, and shalom to the hopeful elect that scatter abroad to the four corners of the earth, which are you so-called blacks, Hispanics, and Native American Indians, and shalom to you speckled birds and years of life foreigners that scatter out in other nations that look like other nations but are in fact Israelites. And the title of this lesson is Remembering the Passover in Egypt and Yahweh Shai's Passover. All right, and you know, as many of you already know, all right, the Passover, you know, is coming up on March 23rd, all right, you know, this Saturday. And, you know, as always, you know, every year, you know, I like to do a lesson, you know, pertaining to, you know, the Passover, all right. I might do a couple of them, you know, going into, you know, how to keep it for you newer brothers and you newer sisters, you know, but this particular lesson right here is going to be ultimately going to be going into, you know, the mentality that you should be having. All right, because every year, you know, around Passover, you know, or during Passover, you know, you notice a lot of Israelites, a lot of Israelite groups, you know, they don't take the Passover serious. You know, they take the Passover as it's a big, you know, dinner or something like that. You know, they'll take it as a, you know, just a big social gathering where you could party, have fun, have fashion shows, you know, have a, you know, a concert, you know, have people singing and this, that, another, you know, all types of madness. All right, you know. And, you know, that's a dangerous spirit to be in. All right. The spirit that we should be in during the Passover is a spirit of, you know, being solemn. All right. Because the Passover is a solemn assembly. All right. During the first Passover in Egypt, you know, it was a lot of death and destruction going on. Yeah. How about Shemiel Shah's reigning, you know, plagues upon that place. All right. You know, and Israel, you know, was pretty much, you know, praying that the plagues would pass over them. You know, in a nutshell, you know, that's why the Lord told Moses, you know, told Israel, you know, to pretty much, you know, put the blood of a lamb over their doorposts and whatnot. So when the death angel, you know, would see that blood, you know, he would pass over him and whatnot. All right. So it was not, you know, a big, happy social gathering, you know, being mirthful, so on and so forth. All right. It was a solemn assembly. Right. You know, because Yahweh Shemiel Shah, he's going to bring plagues on this Egypt. All right, America is spiritual Egypt according to the scriptures. So we need to be in the spirit of praying that Yahweh Shemiel Shah will pass over us when these plagues turn up. All right, you know, and then dealing with the Passover with Yahweh Shai, you know, Yahweh Shai, he was crucified during the Passover. All right, he caught all types of hell. And, you know, going into it, you know, the night before he was crucified, you know, at the Garden of Gethsemane, you know, Yahweh Shai, he was praying that that cup will pass from him, you know, praying that, you know, he wouldn't have to go through, you know, that pain and suffering, you know. So was Yahweh Shai in a mirthful spirit? No, he was in the spirit of being very sorrowful. All right. You know, and I'm gonna get into all that in this lesson. So through the spirit, you know, Lord willing, you know, this lesson is quick, straight to the point, edifying to you brothers and you sisters out there. All right. So we're going to start off with Exodus chapter 12 and we're going to verse 1. And it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months, and it shall be the first month of the year to you. Verse 3, speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. Verse 4, and if the house be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of his, of the souls, every man according to his eating, shall make your account for the lamb. Verse 5, your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. All right, you know, so, you know, and just to add on, you know, that lamb is symbolic for Yahweh Shai. All right, that's why Yahweh Shai is called the lamb. You know, that's why the scriptures also talk about how, you know, Yahweh Shai, he comes in the volume of the book, because even back then that lamb, you know, was symbolic, you know, to Yahweh Shai. All right, but let's continue. Verse 6, and it says, and ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. Verse 7. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts on the upper door posts of the house wherein they shall eat it. Verse 8. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and which bitter herb, slacking with bitter herbs, they shall eat it. All right. So during the Passover, you're supposed to have a, you know, a lamb without blemish. You know, you're supposed to have wine, unleavened bread, and herbs. All right. And they're all symbolic to something. You know, the lamb is symbolic for Yahweh Shai. The wine is symbolic for the blood that he shed for the nation of Israel. All right. The herb is symbolic, you know, for the bitter bondage, you know, that we had to serve in Egypt. All right. Verse 9. And it says, eat it not of raw, eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast it, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and the puritans thereof. Verse 10. Then ye shall let nothing of it remain unto the morning, that which remaineth of it unto the morning ye shall burn with fire. All right. So, you know, whatever is left of the lamb, you know, you're not supposed to keep it. You're supposed to get rid of it and burn it with fire. All right. Verse 11, and it says, and thus shall ye eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover, right? So that goes back to what I said earlier. You know, a lot of these Israelite groups, they, you know, they treat this Passover, you know, like a big dinner. You know what I'm saying? They sit around, they eat, and this, that, and another. You know, they have fun. They're in a mirthful, jolly spirit, so on and so forth. But as we just read right here, you know, you're supposed to eat the Passover in haste, all right? You know, you're not supposed to treat it like just an ordinary dinner. You know, you're enjoying yourself. You know, this dinner tastes good. I'm going to just lounge around and, you know, take my time eating it. No, this Passover is a solemn assembly. All right. And we're supposed to eat the Passover, the lamb, the herb, and all that, everything else in haste. All right. Now, verse 12. Verse 12. And it says, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. All right. So does this seem like a time of mirth? No. Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shai is going to go through the midst of Egypt and smite the firstborn of all the land of Egypt. All right. Both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, he said he'll execute judgment. So Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shai, you know, he was executing judgment during around this time. All right. You know, verse 13, and it says, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the house where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. All right. So like I said, you know, the blood is symbolic for the blood that Yahweh shed for us, the elect. Well, we'll be the elect, you know. So if you're covered by the blood of the lamb, you know, ultimately you're going to be exempt from the judgment that's coming. You know what I'm saying? You know, so that's why I said this is all symbolic. If they had the blood on their doorposts, that would let the death angel know to pass over them. All right. Verse 14. And it says, and this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by ordinance forever. All right. You know, so, yeah, you see what was going on during the first, you know, Passover. All right. You know, nothing was mirthful about this. All right. It was a very serious time. You know, judgment was going on. All right. Major death and destruction upon the land of Egypt. All right. And like I said, you know, this place we're living in right now is also called spiritual Egypt. All right. You could read about that in Revelation chapter 11, I believe. You know, it talks about how, you know, America, you know, it doesn't say America specifically, but, you know, it says, you know, this land is called spiritual Sodom and Egypt. All right. And just look around. You can clearly see why it's called spiritual Sodom. All right. I don't really need to explain that, you know, and it's called spiritual Egypt because of the same customs that ancient Egypt had, America takes on. All right. You know, you see different monuments, the obelisk, you know, the Washington Monument. It's the same thing as what you would see in Egypt. All right. You know, and so on and so forth. So, yeah, this place right here that we're living in, America, is also spiritual Egypt. And the scriptures tell you that the Lord, he's going to bring plagues upon Egypt as before. All right. So knowing that, you know, we shouldn't be in the spirit of being mirthful, you know, using the Passover, you know, as a big social gathering to have fun and have damn fashion shows and whatnot. All right. Because best believe, you know, you're going to see some of that this year. All right. You see it every year. You know, you see it every year amongst these different camps and whatnot, all right? You know, so this is a fair warning because Yahweh Shema Yahushua is going to bring plagues upon his place. And if you're treating the Passover, you know, as if, you know, it's just a, you know, a big social gathering, you know, a dinner, you know, an everyday dinner, you know, you getting together with your family or whatever the case may be, you know, having fun, you know, the Lord's going to rain judgment on you. All right. So let's get 2nd Ezra chapter 15 and verse 10. And it says, behold, my people is led as a flock to the slaughter. I will not suffer them now to dwell in the land of Egypt. All right. Because Yahweh Shema Yahushua is getting ready to deliver the elect out of this place. All right. There's going to be a second exodus that's going to surpass the first. All right. And we are in those times right now. Yahweh Shema Yahushua is about to bring plagues upon this place. The same way that plagues was brought upon ancient Egypt before, you know, Israel was delivered out the place. All right. Verse 12. And it says, Salaki verse 11. And it says, but I will bring them with a mighty hand and a stretched out arm and smite Egypt with plagues as before and will destroy all the land thereof. All right. And this is not talking about ancient Egypt. This is talking about modern day Egypt. All right. Spiritual Egypt, America. All right. And we see in the beginning stages of that. You're seeing the, you know, famines on the horizon. You know, the dollar is getting ready to collapse. You know, you're seeing people rising up against the government, you know, sedition among men. You see these migrants, so-called migrants, crossing the border, coming over here. All right, Yahweh Shema Yahushua is getting ready to, you know, judge this place severely, the same way he did ancient Egypt. All right, let's continue. Verse 12, it says, Egypt shall mourn and the foundation of it shall be smitten with plague and punishment that Yahweh Shema Yahushua shall bring upon it. All right, so Yahweh Shema Yahushua, he's the one that's bringing this judgment upon this place, the same way that he did in ancient Egypt. All right, and like I said, there's about to be a second exodus. All right. That's going to surpass the first. This is Jeremiah chapter 16. We're going to start at verse 14. And it says, therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. All right. Ancient Egypt. Verse 15. But the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north. And all the lands whither he had scattered had driven them, and I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers. All right. So there's about to be a second exodus, you know, that's going to surpass the first exodus. All right. You know, in the first exodus, you know, that was something major. People still talk about it to this day. But this exodus that's about to take place is going to do numbers on that. All right. You know, it's going to run circles around it because the way that the elect is going to be delivered is going to be something that you never seen before. All right. Here it is. People think that, you know, so-called UFOs are little green aliens and so on and so forth. But they're soon going to realize that so-called UFOs are the chariots of the Lord. All right. And that's exactly how the elect is going to be delivered out of America, Babylon the Great, spiritual Egypt, and all the places where we were scattered upon the earth. All right. You know, and not to mention the destruction that's coming with this place. All right. This whole America, all America is going to be a lake of fire. All right. That's never going to be inhabited ever again. So, hey, you see why this place is going to be, you know, the second exodus is going to surpass the first, right? But nevertheless, the point being is that, you know, the Lord is about to bring plagues upon this place like he did, you know, in the first, you know, during the first exodus, all right? You know, so knowing that, you know, why in the hell are you in a mirthful spirit getting ready to have a damn party, you know, and live it up and party it up during Passover, all right? You should be praying that Yahweh Shema Yahushua is going to pass over you, you know, when these plagues, you know, are turned up, all right? And we see that we are at the beginning stages of it, all right? So, you know, that was dealing with, you know, the first Passover, you know, in Egypt. Now I want to go into Yahweh Shai's Passover, all right? You know, and this is going to show you the mentality or the vibe that was going on. It was not a, you know, a mirthful, jolly vibe, all right? You know, it was a very solemn time, all right? Because what you got to understand, you know, you had, you know, Judas, you know, he was, you know, betraying Yahweh Shai, all right? You know, Yahweh Shai, he knew that he's about to be betrayed. You know, he knew that he's about to be persecuted, crucified, so on and so forth, all right? You know, and you got to apply it to this time that we're in right now. The scriptures tell you that the servant, you know, is not greater than his master, roughly paraphrasing. You know, so the same way that Yahweh Shai, he had to catch hell, you know, the elect is about to catch hell too, all right? You know, Esau, Edom, he's about to come down with great wrath in these last days, all right? You know, we're going to have to suffer the same way that Yahweh Shai suffered if we want to get the kingdom. So let's go ahead and get into that. Salakia for the rambling. This is Luke chapter 22. And we're going to start at verse 1, all right? Just to show you that this is during the time of the Passover, all right? So this is Luke chapter 22 and verse 1. It says, now the feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover, all right? This is during the time of the Passover. And it says, and the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people, all right? Talking about Yahushua. Verse 3, then entered Satan into Judea's surnamed Iscariot, being the number of the 12, all right? Verse 4, and it says, and he went his way and communed with the chief priests and the captains, and how he might betray him unto them, all right? So, yeah, you know, like I said, you know, Judas, he betrayed Yahushua during this time, all right? And Yahushua, he knew what was about to happen, you know? So you can only imagine how Yahushua was feeling, all right? Let's continue. Verse 5, and it says, and they were glad and covenanted to give him money. Verse 6, and he promised and sought opportunity to betray him unto them in the absence of the multitude. All right, so you know, you had Judas, you know, plotting against Yahushua. All right, verse 7, then came the day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. Verse 8, and he sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat. Verse 9, and they said unto him, where wert thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall be a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. Verse 11, and ye shall say unto the good man of the house, the master saith unto thee, where is the goose chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? Verse 12, and it says, and he shall show you a large upper room furnished there, make ready. Verse 13, and they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with the desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. All right. So Yahushua, he knew what was getting ready to happen. All right. And keep in mind, like I said, this is during the Passover. All right. Not a mirthful, jolly time. All right. Verse 16. And it says, for I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of Yahushua. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of Yahushua shall come. Verse 19. And it says, and he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, this my body, which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me. All right. So the unleavened bread is representing Yahushua's body. All right. Verse 20. Likewise, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. All right. So the blood, you know, the wine is representing the blood that was shed for Israel. All right. Starting with the elect. Verse 21. And it says, but behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. All right. He's talking about Judas. He's letting them know that one of y'all is going to betray me. All right. You know, so this lets you know that, you know, the vibe, you know, was not a happy vibe, because everybody was on edge. You know, Yahushua, he's pretty much saying, one of you is going to betray me. And the disciples, they was pretty much thinking to themselves, which one is it? You know, they was all on edge. All right. You know, the vibe during this Passover, you know, it was not a mirthful vibe. All right. Verse 22, and it says, and truly the Son of Man goeth as it was determined, but woe unto that man by whom he is betrayed. Talking about Judas. All right. You know, but, you know, I'm not going to read the whole chapter. I just want to get straight to the point. Let's jump down to verse 39. And this is going to show you the spirit that Yahushua was in. All right. Because not only did he know he's going to be betrayed, he knew that he's going to get crucified, you know, but the night before, you know, he's praying to Yahushua that this cup will be taken from him. All right. So he wouldn't have to endure, you know, the pain that he's about to go through. All right. So let's jump down to verse 39. And it says, and he came out and went, as he was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. Verse 40. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. All right. Verse 41. And it says, and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed. All right. And this is in the Garden of Gethsemane. You could read about this in Matthew chapter 26, I believe in John as well. All right. You know, this is in the Garden of Gethsemane. And it says, verse 42, and it says, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. All right. So Yahweh Shai, he knew what was going to happen. All right. His heart was heavy. He was sorrowful. All right. You know, he wanted the cup to be removed from him. But he said, you know, if it be your will. All right. You know, because he was still going to go through it anyway. You know, if it, you know, because he knew the will of the Lord. All right. He was going to endure it anyway. But he was praying to the Lord that if it be your will, you know, can you remove this cup from me? All right. Verse 43. And it says, and there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. All right. So an angel had to come and strengthen Yahweh Shai, because Yahweh Shai himself was in a sorrowful spirit. All right. So like I said earlier, this is the spirit that we should be in, because we know exactly what we finna go through. All right. We finna go through the worst time in history. And here it is. You got Jake walking around the earth, you know, trying to have damn parties during the Passover. Right. Fashion shows, singing contests. All right. You know, so on and so forth. You know, not long ago, I had a sister pretty much, you know, ask me, do I know of any get togethers or functions for the Passover and this, that and other. You know, I pretty much told her that, hey, you know, during the Passover, you're not supposed to be even, you know, trying to indulge in those type of things, all right? Because the Passover is a solemn assembly, all right? You know, you're not supposed to be doing what the rest of these groups are doing, you know, trying to treat the Passover like it's a big party or a dinner, all right? You know, but let's continue. Verse 44. And it says, and there appeared, no, verse 44, yeah. It says, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, all right? So Yahweh Shai was in agony, all right? He was not in a mirthful spirit. And it says, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground. All right, that's how bad Yahweh Shai was sweating. All right, you know, verse 45, and it says, and when he rose up from prayer and was come to his disciples, he found them sleeping for sorrow. Verse 46, and said unto them, why sleep ye? Rise and pray, lest ye enter in temptation. Verse 47, and while he yet spake, behold, a multitude, and he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before him and drew near unto Yahweh Shai to kiss him. Verse 48, but Yahweh Shai said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? Verse 49, and when they which were about him saw what will follow, they said unto him, Lord, shall we smite with the sword? All right, so I'm not even going to read the rest. You know, you could read the rest on your own, but you know, Judas, you know, he betrayed Yahweh Shai, all right? You know, he set Yahweh Shai up, you know, and Yahweh Shai, you know, he ended up getting persecuted, you know, beat, you know, crucified, so on and so forth, all right? And Yahweh Shai, during his Passover, he knew what was coming, all right? He already knew what was coming, all right? That's why he was in a sorrowful spirit. And the same applies to us right now, because we know what's coming, all right? You know, at least those that are sincerely in his truth, because when it comes to a lot of these different Israelite groups, you know, they're not telling their people, you know, what's coming. All right. You know, they're talking about stuff that's irrelevant, you know, that really, you know, don't matter. All right. You know, just stuff that's irrelevant. You know what I'm saying? They're not telling their people the trials and tribulations that's getting ready to come upon this earth. All right. You have some people that even believe that Jacob's trouble is not a thing. You have people that believe that Jacob's trouble happened in 70 AD. All right, you know, and now we're just gonna float our way into the kingdom, you know. But hey, a lot of you Israelites are in for a rude awakening, all right, you know. So let's jump to Revelation chapter 3, because just like you know, Yahweh Shai was persecuted and whatnot, you know, he had his, you know, he had to go through that temptation and whatnot. We about to go through the same thing too, all right. This Revelation chapter 3 and verse 10, and it says, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. All right. You know, this hour of temptation is dealing with Esau, Edom coming down with great wrath, implementing this MOTB, which is indeed the RFID CHIP. All right. Got to say things like that because of YouTube's algorithm, you know, and you're going to be faced, you know, with taking it and getting put to death ultimately, because that's a death sentence, all right? You know, in Revelation chapter 14, it tells you that whoever takes it, you know, pretty much be put in the lake of fire. All right. You know, and if you don't take it, you're still going to be faced with death. All right. You're going to be put on a chopping block, possibly. All right. Revelation chapter 20. You know, you're going to be ostracized from society. All right. You won't be able to buy or sell. So this is the hour of temptation that we're about to face. All right. You know, Yahushua, he had to go through his temptation. You know, like I said earlier, the servant is not greater than his master. You know, we are about to go through that too. All right. You know, and it's going to happen very soon. So why in the hell are you Israelites walking around the earth, you know, like everything is sweet? All right. Treating the Passover like it's a big dinner, you know, a big get together. All right. It's a solemn assembly. And you need to learn that quick, fast, and in a hurry. All right. This is Jeremiah chapter 30 and verse 7. These are the times that we're coming into. And it says, alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. And these are the times that we're in right now. All right. Jacob's trouble is at the door. Elder Apostle Tahar, he already deemed his year, you know, as the hopeful year of Jacob's trouble. All right. And looking at how things going, you know, hey, you know, it looks like we are possibly going down that path. All right. You know, it's been something new every day, every week, you know, literally. All right. Whether it's earthquakes in diverse places, you know, World War III news, you know, you got these immigrants coming over here. You got pestilences, different plagues. You got this eclipse that's coming up. All right. Just did a lesson on that. So much stuff is going on. All right. You know, but here it is. You have Israelites planning to have a big party and get together during the Passover. You got Israelites that's charging, tickets, you know, selling tickets to come to a Passover. All right. You know, you got people that's inviting people that's not even in the truth, you know, public figures in this world, you know, to attend the Passover and so on and so forth. You got Israelites doing that. All right. You know, that's exactly how, you know, a lot of these Israelites don't know what's going on. All right. The scriptures tell you don't, you know, eat the Passover unworthily, you know, and I'm not going to get it. You know, like I said, I might do a separate lesson, you know, dealing with the Passover, you know, later on, you know, but let's get Daniel chapter 12. And let's read verse 1. And it says, in that same time, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as was never since the world was a nation, even to that same time. At that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. All right. And these are the times that we're living in right now. It's pretty much saying the same thing that Jeremiah 30 and 7 talked about, Jacob's trouble. You know, we're going to come into some heavy times where, you know, Michael the archangel is going to have to come back and make divine intervention. All right. That's how bad things are going to be out here. All right. Meanwhile, you know, you have Israelites in a mirthful spirit. All right. Don't know what's going on. You know, just complete, you know, TV static going on in their head. All right. Whenever a TV don't work no more and you see the snow, that's exactly what's going on in a lot of these Israelite heads. All right. You know, they don't have a clue what's coming down the pipe. All right. You know, and it's sad. All right. It's very sad. But I'm going to end off with this. 2nd Ezra chapter 16. You know, and Salakia in verse 74. All right. Because these are the times that we're living in. All right. And it's time to prepare your spirit. All right. It's not the time to be in a mirthful, jolly spirit. All right. The scriptures tell you that it's better to be in the house of mourning than the house of, you know, mirth. Roughly paraphrasing. All right. So this is 2nd Ezra chapter 16 and verse 74. And it says, hear, O ye, my beloved, saith the Lord. Behold, the days of trouble are at hand, but I will deliver you from the same. All right. And these are the times that we're coming into. All right. You know, things are heating up and it's clear to see. All right. Anybody that's paying attention to what's going on earth right now, it's clear to see what's getting ready to take place. All right. So, hey, take this Passover serious. This is the time to be getting that leaven out of your body. All right. You know, trimming off whatever you need to trim off, you know, and taking this Passover serious. All right. You know, it's a solemn assembly. And you need to treat it as such. So with that, you know, Lord willing, you know, this lesson was edifying and exhorting to you brothers and you sisters out there that scattered to the four corners of the earth. And as always, I want to give all praises, honor, and infinite glory to Yahweh, Bahashem Yahushai, Bahashem Rakakudash. Forgive me the spirit to do this lesson. Double honor to the elders and apostles of Great Millstone. And Shalom to you brothers that's out there pushing this truth in sincerity. Shalom.